My name is Johnny Garcia. I grew up in the city of La Puente. Looks like a clean slate, like nothing there, but this is kind of like, I don't know, this is me. This describes where I've been, what I've been through, who I am, just like this, my life. It's like, I don't know, I look at it and I see different, from my wife's lips on my forehead to my kids' names on my cheek to my buddy's name on my chest, and loving memory to different tattoos that mean different things. Just from the song on my forehead. I don't know, I guess it like tells a story when you look at this one, and this is kind of like blank, kind of empty, just tells nothing. I don't know, I don't know how to explain it. It's just weird seeing them.
Growing up, what did tattoos mean to you?
Growing up, tattoos meant belonging to man, like be one of the guys, meant fitting in, it meant being official pretty much to me. I grew up in and out of juvenile hall, just a knucklehead, I thought I was just Mr. Billy Badass, and I did a lot of time in jail for it. It hit me and just really hit me, like, man, I always thought I was young, and I still got time, and my kids are young, and they're not gonna remember this, and they're still babies, and going in and out of jail, and I thought I still had time to play with, and it just hit me. It just, you know, I was sitting in prison, and we're on lockdown, and I've been in my cell almost for 90 days, and I don't know, I was just going through some pictures, and I was looking at my kids, and I was looking at just looking at them and just realizing, like, man, they're not that young anymore. They're getting older, and like it just hit me, just like all the OGs that I looked up to and all the guys I wanted to be like, and it kind of hit me. It kind of like all right, this guy over here, this OG that I look up to, he's 32 years old, but he still lives at home with his mom and stuff. He got two kids, but they call another man dad. I started looking like, damn, this guy over here, this OG, he's 45 years old, and he don't, you know what I mean, he don't got nothing. He never owned his own apartment, never owned his own house. He don't got a driver's license. He don't got nothing. And I start thinking like, man, this is where I'm thriving to be. This is where I'm trying so hard to be. And like, I kind of sat back and I thought about it, like I'm trying my hardest to be a fucking bum. Like, I'm giving up everything I got to be a fucking bum, to be in and out of prison and be one of these guys in 10-15 years, talking about how my wife is sleeping with my best friend because I'm in and out of prison and she's on drugs or whatever the case may be. And I need to get myself established. Like, I waited this long to get established. Like, now when I get out here and try to do it now with all these tattoos and all this, like, once I really want to get serious about it, it's, I don't know, I kind of like gave up hope for a little minute, because I thought, like, man, I'll never be able to do nothing. I'll never be able to get a job or do anything, like, once I really got serious. And but I came out, and I went back to Homeboy Industry and Father Greg. And
Father Greg's been a big role in your life.
Oh yeah, big role. 11, and that's Pops. I went to his services. I went to his service because he's a father, and he goes and he has services at juvenile halls and stuff. And he tries to pretty much get the youth before it's too late. And he caught my attention. He caught my attention. He had a service. And just the way he talked and the way he told his stories, and I could relate to him so much, even though he looked like, I mean, Santa Claus, like, I could relate to him because he would, like, sit there and, yeah, Holmes, and you know the homie, and, I mean, the homie, I told him, he came into my office, I told him, hey, homie, what are you doing, like, wow, you know what I mean, you need to give this gang stuff up, and it's played out, and, I mean, it's a thing of the past, and, like, that's G-Dog, he'll tell you straight up, like, man, that's, you know what I mean, and, yeah, he just caught my ear, and he gave me his card, and he's like, when you get out, he's like, come see me, I got a job for you. And I was like 13 years old, like, hey, what the heck is this guy gonna give me a job? I'm a little kid. But our relationship went like that, back and forth from 13 to 18. He would see me. Every time I'd hear, no matter what facility I was at, every time I'd hear Father Greg is here, I'd try to get to services, try to go to church, just so I could see him, just so I could hear him. Finally, one day I was down and out on my luck, and we're getting kicked out of my mom's house again, and I was going through one of my drawers, and I seen a Homeboy Industry card at the bottom of the drawer. I was like, you know what, let me go see what's up with this guy, Father Greg. He'd been telling me, and come see him. So I went in the office. I went in the office, and he was there, and I asked to see him. I waited about like an hour and a half to go see him. I went in there, I sat down, and he's like, son, he's like, how come you waited so long to come see me? I've been waiting for you. And I looked down, like, what the hell? I didn't even think this guy was gonna remember me, because he sees so many people, so many gang members, so many. I was like, man, this guy ain't gonna remember me. But he remembered me, and just all the work that he did with me, getting me into the union when I was 19, and I messed that up because I wasn't ready for it. Went to prison, messing around with my homeboys and stuff, and wasn't ready for what I was getting. And I got out, and he asked me, well, what do you want to do now? And I told him, well, I want to be on TV. So he sent me down to Central Casting, and I signed up and stuff, and they gave me the whole story. We're not going to call you. You call us. And I was like, yeah, whatever. So I went back, and I gave it to Father Greg, and I gave him the slip that I win and stuff, just to make him happy. And they start calling me, and they start calling me to be on TV and be on shows. And I've been on Southland, CSI Miami, Law and Order LA, Shameless, Another Ordinary Family. I played a lot of gangster roles, and I had two SAG vouchers. One more SAG vouchers, I would have became union. And I still wasn't ready for it. I went back to prison, messing around with my homeboys, hanging around. I had special conditions from getting out the first time, being on parole, not to hang around with them. And I was still hanging around with them, so I got busted for hanging around with them. And that was a time when I was there, sitting there on my last time, and I was thinking, like, I want to get out and do something. So I got out, and I went back to Father Greg, and I told him, you know what, like, I'm ready. And he kind of laughed and said, you know what, I heard this before from you, but you got to show me. I said, all right. I told him, all right, G, that's what we call him, G Dog, G Pops. So I said, all right, G. I left, and I came back, and I started volunteering. I started coming from Azusa to downtown. I started volunteering every day. And about a week goes by, and he calls me in his office. He's like, Johnny, come Monday. I seen you here every day volunteering, helping the homies out. He's like, come Monday, I'm going to start you on payroll. So I was like, all right, cool. I came Monday, and I started me on payroll. And like everyone else, I started as maintenance. And about a week goes by, and I go in there, and I talk to him. I told him, hey, G-Dog, there's only so many times I could clean these restrooms, you know, so many times I clean these windows. He's like, all right, I see you're good with your mouth. You know how to speak to people. He's like, how about I make you a greeter at the front desk? So I was like, oh, man, that's great. So I bumped up to the front desk, took a couple more classes, and I became a tour guide, because people come from around the world to see Homeboy Industries and what we got going on there. And I became a tour guide. And on these tours, I found that lots of the youth really, like, as soon as I start talking, they really listen. So I took a couple more classes, and I became a youth mentor. And I started going back to all the juvenile halls that I was at as a kid and speaking to the youth and camps and stuff like that. And about like 7-8 months goes by at Homeboy Industry doing that. And becoming a public speaker and speaking everywhere on the behalf of Homeboy Industries, from high schools to colleges, to speaking to at Sacramento to Congress about gang intervention. Just, I guess Father Greg seen I was ready, and I had this interview at Park Pictures in the film industry as a PA, a production assistant, and he sent me, he was one of his top five that he sent, and I had no idea what the hell a production assistant was. He told me to go check it out, and I went, did my interview, checked it out, and they hired me on the spot. They said, say goodbye to Homeboy Industry, you start here Monday. And it's been three years, and I've been in the film industry ever since, and it's been great. I've been making good money, able to support my wife and kids and myself, and it's been great.
When you meet people for the first time, are you worried about judgment, or are you?
I was a little difficult when I first started and stuff. People adapting and taking to me and understanding where I come from and who I am. And still to this day, I work with a lot of people. And when I'm on set, when I'm running around, I'm hey, what's up, bro? You need help? Let me help you with this. I'm all over the place and stuff. And lots of people tell me, like, damn, bro, like, when I seen you, fuck, you look like a fucking dickhead. You look like a straight asshole. But once you start talking and shit, you're cool as fuck, man. And yeah, I just have to break them out their shell. And I mean, lots of people ain't really used to seeing people like me. And I guess, I don't know, being the way I am, being like, they probably had encounters with maybe gang members in the past, and probably wasn't so pleasant. Or maybe just all the shit they see on TV or hear about, and they think, because you got tattoos and stuff like that, we're all crazy.
My mom, I'm real close with my mom just because, like, I spent like most of my juvenile life incarcerated, and like no matter where I was at, like my mom, she was at every juvenile facility I was incarcerated at, from Los Pedrinos Juvenile Hall to Central to Silmar to Camp Afrobowl, Camp Rocky, Camp Page, Camp Challenger, Masada Homes, Boys Republic Homes, Placement, any facility I was at, she was there every single weekend. She came and visited me and just made sure I had stuff, and she'd bring letters, because I've been with my wife since she was 14, I was 15. And she stuck by my side the whole time, incarcerated, in and out, and she would always write me letters and give them to my mom, and my mom would bring them to me every weekend, so.
My name is Sandy Turner.
Hi, Sandy.
And you are Daddy's mother.
Great. And you're from?
Azusa?
Shopped them.
Wow. What a difference. They're both handsome, but that was scary. No, but, oh, wow. Different.
When you think of him, in which way do you see him?
The same. He's still my son. But I like the body art. I think it's beautiful.
She said, I ruined my life. What am I doing? It's over. And now my first tattoo was these one right here somewhere, these three little dots, I believe on this side. Three little dots. And she came to see me in juvenile hall, and she's like, oh my God, what are you doing? You're going to ruin your whole life. And
I've been everywhere to see him, the county, everywhere. I'm there for him everywhere. Yes, I mean, it was just like a change since he started going to Homeboys, and it just changed his life, and he's done tremendous change.
You're proud.
Very. Yeah, I am very proud of him. It was very stressful, but I was there. It was scary too, because I would look out the door and I'd hear the helicopter and I'd think, oh my God, Johnny's in one of them. Or I would hear sirens, oh my God, and they'd be calling me, his friends, Johnny's over here, they got him here, they got him over there. And it was just, it was crazy. I think it has a lot to do with the environment, where they grew up and who they grew up with. And I realized that all his friends, where we were, had no fathers. It was all single parents. And so they were looking for, this bond with different, with a man. And that's what I think, that they all bonded together and, you know, got together. That's how I think it came from, you know, just looking for that bond with a man. And then that's where it ends up. You know, this one's doing this for that, and this one's doing that just to make money, and, you know, so that's how it is. But a lot of people get out of it, a lot of people don't.